In this video, I'm going to show you the best, most effective way to learn how to draw backgrounds using Inkscape. I'll show you my personal 5-step technique, a method I've been developing and refining for a long time that helps you improve at an amazing speed while actually making the process fun and enjoyable. If you're new to Inkscape and the channel, hi, my name is Martin. In here, I'll share all kinds of step-by-step tutorials aimed at beginners who want to start making art, but maybe don't enjoy traditional pencil and paper drawing. If you're interested, make sure to like, comment, and subscribe. And if you're curious about getting into background design, whether it's for animation, games, or just want to master Inkscape from scratch, I have something that can help you do exactly that. Stick around until the end to hear more. Before I go over my technique, I want to ask you a question. What is the fastest and easiest way to improve at any level, from a complete beginner to a professional? I'm not talking about practice in general. I mean the strategy behind your practice. In my opinion, the answer is simple. You learn from the masters. If you're a painter, you do Sargent studies. If you're a musician, you analyze Beethoven's scores. If you're a vector artist, you study and analyze art that's been created or could be created with vector tools. There are so many gorgeous cartoon shows that could easily be made, at least partially, in vector art. Today we are going to do a study using my 5-step background technique on a piece from the amazing looking Disney show Star vs. the Forces of Evil, designed by the artist Rafael Hurtado. It's not the most complex or difficult background, but it's beautiful and has a lot to teach us, both in terms of Inkscape tools and in the way the artist simplifies shapes and materials. When we are done, this information will stick in your head and you'll be able to use it in your own projects. By the way, I go much more in depth into building backgrounds and even expanding on these exact 5 steps inside my complete Inkscape course bundle. It has 13 Inkscape courses, over 70 hours of training going over background design and much more. So if you want to take this further, you'll find the link in the description. Now let's get to step 1. Step 1, picking the right reference. You can't just copy anything. You have to consider your medium and your skill level. For example, it's unrealistic to recreate a Studio Ghibli background in Inkscape, but if you pick something overly simple, like a Peppa Pig background, you might not learn much at all. So what I'm saying is that you should find a balance between a challenge and something manageable. I have this nice rule of thumb I always go by: pick a reference you can look at and mentally walk through how you draw it. If you can't figure out where to start on some of the more difficult parts, it's probably too advanced for now. It's fine to push yourself occasionally and pick something where you'll have to figure things out as you go, but be prepared for failure and frustration in that case. In my case, I choose this artwork because I can mentally go through the drawing process. It has a few challenging spots, and I really love its unique shapes, graphic forms, and stylized details. This really looks fun to do as well. Step 2, deconstructing the composition. This step is about breaking the artwork down into its basic building blocks, removing all the details so we can see the structure underneath. Think of it as creating a thumbnail sketch that captures the composition's essential shapes and how they interact. Every major mass in the original should be represented here, matching its location and general form. Here are some tips to be effective at this step. Mark the perspective lines, or at least the horizon line. This will become more important in the later steps. Use the simplest possible shapes to represent the elements. Don't worry if a small part of an object is left out. These are rough guides, and simplicity is more useful at this stage. Group objects together if they visually read as a single mass. Many objects are made up of the smaller ones, and you need to recognize when they function as a single element in the composition. Keep shapes two-dimensional unless they are especially large. We are focusing on 2D compositional shapes, but if something is big and important to the composition, you can make it in 3D to help you in later steps. Sample colors from the general area to keep relationships clear. You can work in grayscale if you plan to switch the colors later, but even then, still pay close attention to the values. When you're done, you should have a simplified version of the scene that still holds all the important compositional information. Step 3. Copying the composition. Now we replace those simplified blocks with the final elements that show up in the reference. Copy from the original as closely as possible, but do not trace over. That would defeat the purpose of this exercise. Guide yourself using the shapes for the position of each element. Feel free to sample the colors if you want. While in a painting study you would probably try to guess as a way to train your color recognition, here I think that's not entirely needed. I much prefer to leave the colors for a unique, separate exercise. Also remember that you don't need perfection. I'm often a little messy here, plus you're not gonna show this to anyone. The real goal is twofold. Learn how to use Inkscape's tools to achieve different parts of the illustration, how to make these textures, shapes, shadows, etc. And memorize the artist's stylistic choices. How they shape the bushes, handle the textures, design the silhouettes. One will get you familiar with the program's tools and basic drawing techniques, and the other will help you build your visual library. Two extremely essential parts of any study. The end result should be something that looks pretty similar to the original, except perhaps for a couple of places where you thought it didn't matter if you weren't 100% accurate. Step 4. Rearranging the composition. Here we take the original composition's building blocks and rearrange them to create a new layout. That's why I told you to keep a copy of the thumbnail in the last step. We are not aiming for originality here. This is an exercise to train your eye and mind to understand composition. By shuffling shapes around, you get a feel for how the arrangement changes the scene. How similar or different depends on you and what you feel comfortable. But keep in mind that the more different the composition turns out, the more likely you have to improvise on the next step when you're building a full illustration on top. Because we are handling super simple shapes, it makes sense to not just make one variation, but make as many as you want. This way you get to pick which version you like the most. The only tip I can give you is to be mindful of the perspective. That's why I recommended you to make a quick indication of the horizon line. Use it as a guide to keep the shapes consistent. If you want, you could take these shapes and really do a completely different composition with different perspective and colors and compositional ideas. But then the purpose of this exercise will be gone. Remember, our main goal here is to learn from the reference, not to create something entirely new from our heads. We want to deconstruct it and see how the artist used each element of the composition to build an illustration. Anyway, when you're done, pick your favorite variation, or at least the one that you think it will be easier to finish, and move on to the next step. Step 5. Reconstructing the composition. Okay, now just like in step 3, we are replacing these blocks by drawing the final scene on top, using the reference as a guide. Because all we did was to move around the compositional shapes, most elements can still be copied directly from the reference. You have to improvise and adapt them to new proportions and locations, and invent new detail. This will test how well you've internalized the artist's style and Inkscape tools, which should be fresh in your mind if you followed the previous steps. One of the awesome things about vector illustration is that it's really easy to reuse a lot of stuff. I don't see a problem in grabbing some of the elements you finished in step 3 and bringing them in here to save some drawing time. Depending on how much you've messed with the shapes in the previous step, you'll have to adjust them more or less. The end result will probably not look 100% as good as the original, and part of that is because we are basically drawing with just a single reference. You may be tempted to bring in more reference and make this a proper illustration, but I personally do not recommend you to do that. The goal is to learn from what's on the reference, not to make a nice illustration. And I feel bringing in more reference would muddy what is in there to learn. If you want, you can and should make more than one finished illustration. You should have made at least 4 or 5 composition rearrangements in step 4, so you can pick one and practice more in this step. More practice is always better. And there you have it. a new original composition built from studying an existing one. Remember, this is a study, so don't present it as entirely your own. Once you master this method, you can adapt it to create fully original pieces, but that's a subject for another video. If you enjoyed this tutorial, I got plenty more on background design and Inkscape, so make sure to subscribe. Likes and comments are highly appreciated, and don't forget to check out the bundle, it really helps me and the channel. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you in the next week. Bye!